Coming up on Mayo Clinic Q&A.
HIPEC is like a chemical to just kind of sterilize the microscopic stuff the surgeon can't see. And so that's why combined with surgery to remove everything that we can see and then chemotherapy to get rid of the stuff we can't see, those two together then increase our success rate or our likelihood of the cancer not coming back.
HIPEC, or Hyperthermic Intraperitoneal Chemotherapy, is used for many patients with advanced abdominal cancers. It's an alternative to traditional chemotherapy or radiation therapy. HIPEC is placed directly in contact with the tumors to kill cancer cells that may remain after surgery. And since this type of chemotherapy doesn't go throughout the body, higher doses of the drugs can be used.
Welcome everyone to Mayo Clinic Q&A. I'm Dee Dee Steepen, sitting in for Dr. Helena Gazelka. HIPEC stands for Hypothermic Intraperitoneal Chemotherapy. Hypothermic means warm or hot. Intraperitoneal means inside the abdominal cavity, which is encased in a sac called the peritoneum. HIPEC is used in conjunction with cancer surgery, using high-dose chemotherapy to kill microscopic cancer cells inside the abdominal cavity. Heating the chemotherapy drugs enhances the procedure's effectiveness. When the chemotherapy is hot, it penetrates the tissue more deeply, increasing the number of cancer cells it can reach. Here with us to discuss is Dr. Travis Grotz, a surgical oncologist at Mayo Clinic. Welcome to the program. Thanks so much for joining us.
Good morning, Dee Dee. Thanks for having me.
Of course. So what cancers can be treated with HIPEC, and which patients would be eligible for this?
Sure. So HIPEC, as you said, is kind of regional chemotherapy in the abdomen. So really any cancer that's just localized in the abdomen on the surface of the peritoneum, like you said, could be a candidate. There's certainly some tumors that have been well studied, and we know for sure based on studies and data that works well. So those cancers are cancers of the colon, cancers of the appendix, cancers of the ovaries, cancers of the stomach. And then there's even a cancer of the lining of the peritoneum called mesothelioma. So those would be the cancers I think that are well studied and well accepted. There's always rare tumors that we have less data for, such as cancers of the pancreas or gallbladder or small intestine, that we don't know yet if that's the right treatment.
Sounds good. And can you explain sort of in lay terms how exactly this works?
Sure. So the way I kind of explain it to people is that it's like if you have a dirty countertop or table, you want to clean off all the dirt and grime and stuff. And so surgery, the surgical part of the HIPEC, is to remove any tumor the surgeon can see. But if you want to eat on that countertop, you want it clean and sterile and get rid of the bacteria. So we use chemicals like bleach or antibacterial disinfectants to clean the countertop. So HIPEC is like a chemical to just kind of sterilize the microscopic stuff the surgeon can't see. And so that's why combined with surgery to remove everything that we can see and then chemotherapy to get rid of the stuff we can't see, those two together then increase our success rate or our likelihood of the cancer not coming back.
That's a great explanation. I like that comparison. So who can perform HIPEC?
So, HIPEC is a pretty complex procedure. There's a long learning curve from the surgeon standpoint, the hospital standpoint, the anesthesia, the whole team standpoint. So it takes specialized training. So most places that are most people, surgeons who do it are what's called surgical oncologists, which are cancer surgeons who have, they're general surgeons who have done another 2 years of additional focused training in cancer surgery. And part of that 2 year time is dedicated to HIPEC. So cancer surgeons and then also gynecologic oncologists are also for ovarian cancer also are specialized in HIPEC.
Very good. And what can patients expect to experience during a HIPEC procedure?
Sure. I think this is probably one of the hardest questions to answer because it's very variable depending upon the surgery component of it. So some patients may have lots of tumor, may need a more extensive surgery component of it. And so obviously the more extensive the surgery will be, the longer the recovery and higher risk of complications and things like that. And some people have very little tumor in their abdomen. And so the surgery can actually be very minimal. And so those patients may recover much quicker. And then sometimes we even do the HIPEC alone without surgery. And so that, obviously would have a different recovery. But in general, I would say the chemotherapy, what it adds to, or HIPEC, what it adds to the surgery is probably, you know, some fatigue. I think I always warn patients it's going to take several months for them to get their stamina level up. It just kind of wears people out. I think there's also a component, you know, your bowels are bathed in chemotherapy. So there's some irritable bowel kind of symptoms that people can experience, like gassy abdominal cramping, you know, intermittent nausea or diarrhea. It's generally mild and again, resolves over a few months, but it's something that people can experience. But in general, there's less side effects than giving it through the vein. And that's the whole reason why we do the HIPEC, is because less of it's being absorbed. So there's less side effects, in general.
What are the risks of, this procedure?
Sure. So, you know, the risks of HIPEC, again, just the HIPEC portion, you know, the chemo again is usually not, as much of it as absorbed, but some can be. And so some chemotherapy drugs we use, depending on the type of cancer, can be hard on the kidneys. And so there's certain things that we do to decrease that risk. And usually using those parameters or those extra steps minimizes that risk. Again, the fatigue we talked about, the irritable bowels we talked about, it can drop your counts. Again, usually like your white cell counts and things like that. Usually that's mild and not, you know, really a problem, but another thing to watch out for after surgery or after HIPEC.
And what are we talking, what kind of success rate does this HIPEC procedure have?
Sure. So that's, you know, that's very variable again. And it depends on two things, really, I think are the two most important. One is the ability of the surgeon to get all the tumor out. So that's, you know, when surgeons are evaluating patients, if they're candidates, they have to be confident they can remove all the tumor. That's a critical step is being able to remove all the tumor and in terms of success. And then second part is the type of tumor. So some tumors are slower growing, and are maybe more sensitive to chemotherapy and are also less invasive, meaning less sticky, so we can peel them off pretty easy. So those tumors like the classic pseudomyxoma peritonei, which is jelly belly is another name for that, where it's a tumor of the appendix. It's very mucinous, a lot of jelly. Those tumors, you know, the survival, long-term survival can be quite high, 60-70%. So that success rate's very high. In some tumors, very aggressive tumors like stomach cancer, colon cancer, you know, the success rate might be, you know, lower, long-term success rate, you know, more in the kind of 25 to 35, 40% range. So that's kind of long-term success. Short-term success, I think of is an important part too. I think, you know, chemotherapy is no fun. So the surgery, oftentimes, even if we're not successful in the long-term, can extend people's survival in the short term and provide time off of therapy where people don't have any cancer, they're not getting any treatment. And that time frame is you know, variable again, but at least it usually on average provides some time, a year and a half or 2 years of time without any cancer recurrence and off of therapy. So that can be a short-term benefit as well.
Very good. You talked a little bit about what recovery is like for patients, kind of depends a little bit. Is there anything else that people should know about recovery?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, it might be helpful to talk to other patients who've gone through it. And there's a lot of, you know, online, you know, websites and other patients, and there's, you know, podcasts like this and other webinars that kind of explain it. But again, everybody's individual, so it's hard to, you know, take too much from each person's experience. But I think, again, people just need to know that it is a big surgery and that there's, you know, they'll need some help at home and some recovery. And I think one of the hard things people struggle with is that general, you know, several month period of, again, the fatigue and, you know, not feeling the greatest. And I think it kind of leads to some depression. I mean, I think it's hard to feel kind of blah for a couple of months. And so I think getting that support from your family and friends and recognizing that and trying to find, you know, joy in life and things around you and what you can do is helpful. And so I think that's something we try to help patients with in recovery point too.
Absolutely. That's so important. What are some questions patients should ask their healthcare professionals about HIPEC when they're, you know, when they're at these appointments?
Yeah. I mean, hopefully they're getting a good explanation like this about, you know, what to expect about the surgery. You know, there's the surgery side of the HIPEC. There are, you know, surgeons can do laparoscopy, which is minimally invasive surgery, where they stick a camera in and take a look around to see where the cancer is. We can get scans like CT scans, MRIs. So we can get a good idea of how extensive surgery would be, but there's always a little bit of unknown, which I think is sometimes hard for patients because at the end of the day, our goal is to get all the tumor out. And so there might be, when we get in there, we might see tumor we didn't see before on the laparoscopy or the CT scan. And so surgery can sometimes change in the operating room. Again, the goal is to get all the cancer out and, you know, obviously have good outcome in terms of quality of life and recovery. And so that's a fine balance that's always, you know, what the surgeon's trying to strive to get. So I think, you know, they need to learn from the surgeon what they anticipate the surgery would look like and how extensive it would be. But they have to recognize there's going to be some flexibility. I think, again, it's a very complex surgery. So I think, you know, it is one of those ones where there's a direct volume to outcome relationship in terms of how patients do. And, you know, most surgeries, you know, you do 20 or 30 of them and you kind of gotten over the learning curve and surgeons are competent and comfortable with it. But this surgery, actually the research suggests it's closer to 120, 150 procedures before, you know, the outcomes are really ideal. And so I think it's important, not just from the surgeon standpoint, but the whole institution and having the whole progress, a process of, you know, medical oncologists and their enrollment and involvement in chemotherapy and having the nutritionists and the nurses and the anesthesiologists and the whole multidisciplinary team, I think is really important. So those are things to ask about, I guess.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's very interesting. Is HIPEC available at all cancer centers? And is it covered by insurance?
Good questions. So like I said, again, it is somewhat regionalized just given the complexity of it. So not available probably at every cancer center, but it is available at most or a lot of cancer centers. There are, you know, several that are, you know, very high volume, and there's many that do a fair amount. As far as insurance coverage, that's always a tough one because it's every insurance is different. Mm-hmm. But again, I think the ones I just mentioned before, colon, appendix, stomach, and ovarian cancer, there's very good data, you know, high level data, research trials that suggest that there's a significant benefit to the HIPEC portion of the procedure. And so those in general are covered by insurance companies. The other ones where we have less data for it, those are a little bit tougher just because they're either less common or less well studied. And so those are a little harder sometimes to get insurance to cover.
Good to know. Well, our thanks to Dr. Travis Grotz, a surgical oncologist at Mayo Clinic, for being with us today. Thanks for the great conversation.
Thanks, Dee Dee. Appreciate it.
Mayo Clinic Q&A is a production of the Mayo Clinic News Network and is available wherever you get and subscribe to your favorite podcasts. To see a list of all Mayo Clinic podcasts, visit newsnetwork.mayoclinic.org. Then click on podcasts. Thanks for listening and be well. We hope you'll offer a review of this and other episodes when the option is available. Comments and questions can also be sent to Mayo Clinic News Network at mayo.edu.